the 200 words which are literally changing the world. And he looked up in amazement and he said, where did this come from? And it, right there in the second step was God. And God was liberally scattered throughout the steps. And he realized that without God, there was no recovery. Without a higher power of our own understanding, there was no recovery. That this was a spiritual program from Alpha to Omega, from A to Z. There is no spiritual part of AA. It's all spiritual, each and every step. And we're going to be taking a look at the first step. We need to put aside something which has gotten some very strong play recently, and I don't know where it comes from, but there is somewhere the idea got started that the way that we determine whether we're alcoholics or not is to determine that our lives are unmanageable. If you stop to think about it, that doesn't make any sense at all. Show me some of those normies out there whose lives are manageable by themselves. You see, the very basic idea of our program and of the 12 steps, right down at the rock bottom of everything, is the fact that God has all power and knowledge, and His will is going to be done whether we like it or not, and all of our attempts to manage our own lives will come to naught. The point is, we got to stop playing God, we got to stop being the general manager of our universe. And our whole point is to surrender and to seek knowledge of God's will for us and be willing to be obedient to that will. That's the way our lives turn around. The idea that somehow if we answer a 300 question questionnaire about unmanageability that we have proven the facts of our alcoholism is a patent absurdity. What the first step is telling us is that because we're alcoholics, we have an unmanageable life. There's no other way around. We are not alcoholics because our lives have become unmanageable. And so this is not something which the Big Book dwells upon at all, with good reason. Let's take a look at the second full paragraph on page 30 now, because the Big Book does describe and define the first step for us, does it not? Let's see what it says. We learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we were alcoholic. This is the first step in recovery. Notice what this is saying. First of all, this is something we're going to learn. It's going to come to us. Not something being forced upon us. Not something that's beaten into our heads. Nobody opens up the top of our heads and pours in this concession. It's something we learn. And that means that we have learned because we have taken certain actions, which we're going to talk about in a minute. We learned that we had to fully concede. Now, you know, the Big Book doesn't have any weasel words in it. It doesn't mess around with any if, as, when, comes, and maybes. It didn't have any bunch of gray areas in it. It tells us straight out, in plain, unambiguous language, what the facts are and what we must do and what the directions are that we must follow. And so it tells us that we learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we were alcoholics. Innermost selves. This doesn't mean that because we have come to a meeting and announced my name is Jim and I'm an alcoholic that we've accomplished the first step. We may have, but it doesn't signify that. What then does? The concession to our innermost selves means that this step must be taken without qualifications or reservations of any kind. Now this is something which is almost impossible for us to do when we walk in the door. You know, to ask an alcoholic who's sick, sore, and wounded, can't figure out what's going on, been in a state of denial for years and years and years, to suddenly concede fully to their innermost selves that yes, indeed, I'm an alcoholic, Some can do it, but many, many cannot. They will say it. They will pacify those who are around them, who may even be their sponsors or whatever, or the counselors at the treatment center or down at the detox or whoever it is that has hold of them at the moment. But has it really happened? This is the question we need to ask. Is this a concession without reservation? Because if there are reservations, we're not going to recover. This is perhaps the single most critical moment in the life of an alcoholic. This is the nexus point beyond which lies recovery. I don't know whether any of you suspect that you have special merit for being here. I know that I do not. And I have considered the fact that I was chosen, and I believe it would be so, to be a member of this wonderful fellowship as an act of grace. And I'm grateful, and will be to my dying day, that that is so. Because as a result of being given these wonderful tools, these 12 steps to use, I've had a life beyond anything I could ever imagine for myself. To recount what has happened in my days of sobriety would take all night. Nothing so greatly spectacular, but it's been a life far greater than anything ever could have happened to me otherwise. Not to speak of the fact that I would have been dead within a year, I'm certain of that. So now let's think about this business of this disease of alcoholism and what's going on here. This stuff's been around for a long, long time. Recently, it was discovered that in the caves outside Peking, China, where they discovered Peking Man, that those guys 225,000 years ago were fermenting berries. And you know that there were a bunch of drunks in those caves. And they didn't have any more chance of survival than we did. We find that alcohol and its attendant terrors and the ravages upon certain members of the human race have been around forever. And strangely enough, lots and lots of people, the vast majority of people, can imbibe alcohol with impunity. But we can't. And we can call this an allergy if we want. Dr. Silkworth thought that that was the best, closest term he could come up with. There's something wrong with us, or let's put it another way, there's something different about us. That when we take alcohol into our bodies, something happens to us. Dr. Silkworth called it a phenomenon of craving. Something happens which physically and mentally drives us to continue to drink, regardless of the consequences. And in many instances, until we have reached the total satiation point, saturation point, and we pass out. Many of us, millions of us, unfortunately, have carried that one step further and continue to drink until we die. Why? We don't know for sure, but we do know that we are identifiable. You can pick us out of the population. You can go to any party, and since all of us around here now have a lot of experience with this, we spot the alcoholic right off. The two-fisted drinker, or the double, triple, quadruple dipper. The one who is always running back to the kitchen to fill everybody else's drink. The person with the hip flask. The person we meet at 9 o'clock in the morning who is very busily eating breath mints. Looks like they've just been dragged through the streets and are saying that they had an insomniac night and they probably are coming down with the flu. All of us know about Monday flu. Sometimes Monday and Tuesday flu. And then sometimes it's all week. And then, we learned to run out and find friendly doctors who would medicate us. And some of those medications were pretty damn nice. Wow, that stuff is good. What do you need booze for with this stuff? Plus, it's nice and legal. So we've been that route. And that's why we're here, you know. That's